Hello all, this is the fourth lecture on the topic refraction. Today we are going to talk about refraction through prism and total internal reflection. Now we talked about glass slab. In glass slab, both surfaces are parallel. In a glass slab, the both surfaces are parallel. So if the ray is incident like this, what happens? Finally, it goes like this. So these two rays are parallel to each other. The reason being, both these surfaces are parallel, so this incident ray and emergent ray also, they become parallel. Now when we deal with prism, we say that prism deviates the ray. Okay, so suppose we have a prism, these are 3D thing. So these two surfaces, we can call it refracting surfaces. This is base. Okay, so this is the base of the prism. These two are refracting surfaces, and this is called angle of prism. Okay, this A is called angle of prism. Now since we know about triangles, it can be 60, 60, 60, it can be 90, 45, and so on. There can be very different set of angles. Okay, so we'll talk about it. So we can have right angle prism, we can have isosceles prism, we can have equilateral prism, and so on. Now this is the angle of prism. So suppose now this is our incident ray. Okay, and actually there is an experiment also in your syllabus in which you have to draw this diagram by yourself in lab. So suppose this is a laser light and it's incident on this. Now a lot of the students do a mistake of drawing normal. So on this surface, if I draw a line, now this is normal N1. Okay, on the first phase, this is perpendicular to this. Now the ray is going from air to glass, so it will bend towards the normal. So let us say it bends like this, and on this surface again I draw a normal. This is N2. Again this will make 90 degree with the prism side. Now it will bend away from the normal. Now let us label it. This is I1, this is, let us say, R1, this is R2, and let us say this is I2. Now here R1 is the angle of refraction on the first phase, R2 is the angle of incidence on the second phase, and I2 is the angle of refraction on the second phase, right? So we have used R2 as an angle of incidence. We are using this diagram, or we are using this notation, because in the book also you will find they use this only. So this is the angle of refraction on this phase, angle of incidence on this phase, and angle of refraction on this phase. Right, now if I extend the incident ray like this, and if I extend the emergent ray or reflected ray like this, this angle is known as angle of deviation. Okay, so this is called angle of deviation. Now this angle of deviation, you can see, is the angle between incident and emergent ray. Okay, we can say angle, the angle of deviation in glass slab between incident and emergent ray was 0 degree, because both were parallel. Here it is this. Now in the experiment, what you do in your class, you will put a pin here okay, and you have to look from this side to see the pin. Now, can you guys figure out where you will see the pin? As we talked about in the last lesson also, your eyes cannot see all this bending. It will see the light to be a straight line only. So actually what happens that if you see from this side, you will see the pin here. Actually, this pin will appear here. And then you have to fix a pin along the straight line. So you will fix up. So what you will find that this pin will be deviated by an angle which is this only. Okay, this will be vertically, so it will be deviated by angle of deviation delta only. Okay, now we'll not talk about this, but just to make you understand, if you see from here, actually you will not see something like this, you will see something on this straight line only. Now this angle of deviation, as if it depends on following parameters, this angle of deviation depends on I. Okay, it depends on angle of incidence . It depends on refractive index of the material. If it depends on refractive index, then it will also depend on wavelength. It depends on wavelength. And it also depends on angle of prism. A. Now, let us talk about n and lambda. So more the refractive index, it is observed that more bending take place. Okay, so if n increases, then deviation also increases. Now if I go to wavelength part now, and if you guys remember what is dispersion, then wavelength is inversely proportional to this. So wavelength of red light is more than the wavelength of violet light. This also means, since n is inversely proportional to lambda square or something, then nr will be less than nb. So the violet will deviate most. Okay, so as the wavelength increases, angle of deviation will decrease. Okay, so this is about this. Second says that as lambda increases, this also means deviation decreases. That's why red deviates the least in case of dispersion. Now, in your book they talk about crown and flint, means glass can have two varieties or more than that. So one is crown prism, one is flint prism, and depending on refractive index means they actually differ. So one will deviate more or less and so on. Now going back to this, through experiment it is found that this, as you increase A for a small angle prism, the angle of deviation also increases. Okay, so from experiment it is found that if A increases for a small angle prism, then angle of deviation also increases. Now we are left with the explanation for this I, how I depends on angle of deviation. Now you all can sort of see that as I change I, of course this will also change according to Snell's law. This will change, this will change. So this angle of deviation also changes. Now there is a experiment which they do with prism. What they do, suppose this is a laser light. So keeping laser light fixed, they will slowly rotate the prism. So as you rotate the prism, you can see, as you rotate the prism, then this angle of incidence will change. Then they will measure the angle of deviation. So this experiment is done with a laser light and a prism, where laser light is fixed and prism is slowly rotated, and then they plot a graph, and the graph looks like this. This is angle of deviation, this is angle of incidence. It looks like something like this. Now in the graph, and let me write it, this is some I1 equal to I2. Okay, now the angle of deviation somehow depends on angle of incidence. So this graph tells you that as if you observe this part from here to here, as the angle of deviation, as the angle of incidence is increased, angle of deviation decreases and it reaches a minimum. This is called minimum deviation angle or angle of minimum deviation. Now, as the angle of incidence increases, the angle of deviation decreases, and after that, as the angle of incidence is increased, again it increases, deviation increases, right? Now, this how the angle of deviation depends on I. Now, this minimum angle of deviation is of importance. At minimum angle of deviation, I1 is equal to I2. Okay, so at minimum deviation, I1 is equal to I2. If you use Snell's law on this surface and this surface, this also means that R1 will be equal to R2. Now, if this R1 and R2 are equal, then this refracted ray will become parallel to the base. Okay, so at minimum deviation, now this all things are of minimum deviation. At minimum deviation, I1 is equal to I2, R1 is equal to R2, and the refracted ray inside, okay, I'm just drawing the, this will become parallel to the base, okay. The refracted ray becomes parallel to base, okay. Now this is all you have to know about angle of minimum deviation. What happened? This is true, and because of that, this also becomes true. Now, there are a lot of formulas in your book relating all of them. One formula, actually in your syllabus, they don't talk about formula at all. So you have to know this idea. And there are some relations. If you see this one, I'm talking about this triangle. Then this angle is this and this and this. This is exterior angle, these are interior angle, I am talking about this and this. You can do this exercise by your own and you will find that it is equal to sum of interior angle and it will be something like this. So this is one formula, okay, which comes out that angle, exterior angle is equal to sum of interior angle, and this R1 plus R2 is equal to A. Okay, is equal to angle of prism. Generally, they have not asked anything related with this formula. These ideas are important. Only one thing, please try to understand how to draw normal in the case of prism. Okay, now we'll move to the next topic, that is called total internal reflection. In total, now we are going to talk about the second topic for today's lecture, that is total internal reflection. Now you can see the word reflection, okay, and if you talk about reflection, then generally we think of mirror, polished surface where reflection happens. Now one thing I have mentioned or not, whenever refraction takes place, some reflection will be always there. Okay, so in general, suppose you have a transparent medium, light is coming in. Depending on the nature of the medium, some light will be always reflected. So this is incident ray, some part will be always reflected and some part will be always refracted in a transparent medium I am talking about. Now this plays a very important role. Now depending on the medium, if it is transparent, then we don't talk about this. Generally, we ignore this, and if it's polished, then we ignore this. Okay, but this, whenever refraction will happen, some reflection will always be there, but generally we ignore it. Okay, now in total internal reflection, suppose this is a Now, this is suppose some medium 1, 2, and we are assuming this medium is denser. First medium is denser medium, and second medium is rarer. Now, let us say we incident light from here, and it is transparent medium, so we are not talking about refraction, and the ray will be bending away from the normal. This is I, and this is R. If I apply Snell's law here, then N1 sin I will be equal to N2 sin R. According to Snell's law, this product is constant. Now, what will happen? Suppose I increase I. Now here, see, light is going from denser to rarer medium. Okay, that is, we'll talk about the necessary condition. So if I increase I, N1, N2 are fixed, then R will also go up. So if I increase I, R also goes up. Okay, that means as I go on increasing I, this R will also go on increasing. Okay, this, now as I go on increasing I, R also increases, will reach one point where this ray, the angle of refraction will become 90 degree. Okay, and I am writing this angle to be IC, we'll talk about it. So this is simple, as I increase I, R increases, so R is increasing like this, at one point R will become 90 degree. Now after this, you can see if you increase I more, then this ray will come inside this first medium only. Then what happens? If you incident, if this I is more than IC, then this surface will behave like a plane mirror. Okay, now the summary is, as I increase I, R increases, and if I increase I more than this, then this ray will come inside, and this phenomenon is called total internal reflection. Now there are two conditions for total internal reflection. The first condition being, light has to go from denser to rarer medium. So two conditions. First, light has to go from denser to rarer medium. Okay. Second, I must be greater than IC, and better to write in words, the angle of incidence between these two medium should be more than the critical angle. Okay. Now, if you apply Snell's law here, then you will find N1 sin IC is equal to N2 sin R, which is 90 degree. I am applying Snell's law here. Then I will get sin IC is equal to N2 by N1, sin 90 is 1, or sin IC, I can write it this to be N1 by N2. Now, Just to make it simple, suppose this is glass, this is air. So first medium is glass, this is air. So this becomes 1 by Ng or by 1 by Na, and which is nothing but sin IC is 1 NgA. Now that means critical angle, sine of critical angle depends on the refractive index of the pair of medium. Okay, it is reciprocal of the refractive index. Now we know that NgA is 1.5, so we can calculate. So since NgA is 1.5, using calculator which is not needed, you can calculate this angle IC comes out to be 42 degrees. So this is critical angle for glass air interface. Now that means if I have glass and air, if I incident at 42 degree, the ray will become like this. But if I incident more than that, then it will bend. Now there are some very important application of refraction, total internal reflection. Before going there, just remember, light has to go from the denser to rarer, and angle of incidence should be more than the critical angle. Now there are very important application of total internal refraction. One is in optical fiber. So in some application, the most important we are going to not discuss, just we'll talk about it a bit. In fiber optics, you have in optical fiber you have very fine layer of, you can say, glass kind of thing, and it has a lot of engineering into it. It has something called core and cladding, whatever. So by which you can send the signal, and light will go from denser to rarer medium. Let us say outside is air, and somehow through optical fiber, the signal can go, and this can transfer the signal with very less loss in intensity. So when we transmit the signal using total internal reflection, the loss is less, but of course it is there. And it's amazing to say that you can transfer data or signal from here to US and so on through optical fibers. Now, you guys know or don't know, there is something called endoscopy also. So in endoscopy, internal organs can be checked by doctor by inserting a very thin pipe kind of thing. Again, they use total internal reflection there. Then you have sparkling of diamond, actually is because of total internal reflection. Okay, we'll not talk about it, but is there. Then if you see mirage in a hot day, if you see mirage over the road, that is also because of total internal reflection. Right, now we are going to quickly discuss total internal reflection in case of prism. While discussing it, please remember that critical angle for a glass is 42 degree. Okay, so I will talk about some application of prism on total internal reflection. Now, first case, let us say we have a isosceles prism. This is 90, this is 45, this is 45. If the light is incident like this, then in the second case, let us say we have a isosceles prism. Again, this is 90, this is 45, and this is 45. And third case, suppose I have a equilateral prism, and this is 60, 60, and 60. Now, suppose light is incident like this here, and suppose light is incident like this here. Now, it's just the matter of geometry, okay, how the thing will change. So you can see, if I draw a normal angle of incidence is 0 here, it will travel straight. Now if I draw a normal here, you can do simple geometry. This is 90, this is 45, this is 45. This angle will be 45. Now this angle is 45. Now light is all, again going from glass to air, means denser to rarer medium, and critical angle is 42 degrees. So it is more than the critical angle. So it will undergo total internal reflection, and this part will act like a mirror. Okay. So by making the same angle 45 degree, it will go like this, and again angle of incidence is zero in this. Now in this case you have deviated a ray by 90 degree. Okay. It was going like this, then it is going like this. So angle of deviation is 90 degree. Now in this case again angle of incidence is zero, it goes undeviated, you draw a normal, use geometry 45 90, again it will come out to be 45. It will act like a plane mirror. By making the same angle, it will go like this. Again on the surface, if you do the geometry, it is going from glass to air, 45, and again it comes back. Now here you have deviated the ray by 180 degree. So incident ray was going like this, emergent ray is coming like this, and angle of deviation is 180 degree. This is called poroprism. Actually this function is used in binoculars, in prism binoculars, and this is called poroprism. Actually it's more complicated arrangement than this, but this action is used in binocular. Now in this equilateral prism, again angle, you can see this angle of incidence is zero, it will go undeviated. If you draw a normal here and use the idea, then this is 90, 60, and this will be 30. This has to be 60. So now again light is going from glass to air, so it is more than 42 degree. By making same angle 60, let me just redraw it again. So now making the same angle, this becomes 60 degree. By making same angle, it comes out, and you will find that it will go like this. Now very quickly we'll talk about one more example where total internal reflection does not take place. Okay. Now let us discuss quickly this case. This is 60 degree, this is 90, and this is 30. Now let us say ray is going like this. Now angle of incidence is zero, it will go undeviated. If you draw a normal here and use geometry, this is 90, 30, 120, this will be 60. So angle of incidence will be 30 degree. Now light is going from denser to rarer medium, this is less than critical angle, so only refraction will happen. So it bend away from the normal like this. Let us take one more example. You have the same prism, 60, 90 and 30. And suppose ray is coming like this. Right. Now angle of incidence is zero, it goes undeviated. This is the normal. Now again use the concept, this is 90, 30, 120, this is 60. So angle of incidence is just 30 degree. Right. So it will bend away from the normal. So there are